Everybody, welcome back to another episode of I've Got Questions, a pre-modern podcast with myself, William Hurst. And we are rolling along with our PSS retrospectives. And today we have that Bills fan. I'm pretty sure I got that right. The Bills. Yeah. Coming straight from New Jersey. Tom Metelsky, fresh off a top eight at the Sacred Torch. Tom, how are we doing today?
Doing good, Will. Thanks for having me on.
Always.
It's sad the PSS is over, but I was, you know, I'm glad we got to spend time to, you know, talk pre-modern for a few months.
Absolutely. It was a very special time for me, regardless. And, you know, I have a distinction of being the very best of being the worst this time around. So we'll take that to heart, wear it like a badge of honor. But today we're talking about you. And first thing we usually get into is, this is not your first PSS, correct?
Correct. It's my third one.
It's your third one. So once you were reached out to, what thoughts went through your head? You've been through the rodeo before. Was there a drive to like, I've done this, I've been successful. I was runner up last year. Last year, right? Because you run up with Rich, right? It was like, now this year, it's going to be my year. Where were you at when you kind of got the invitation?
So I remember PSS, the first PSS, I don't think I was playing pre-modern yet. The second one I remember watching, but it was more of, I think the second one was all about brews. And I remember, you know, I was just exiting Legacy and Modern Pauper competitively. Even though I still play Legacy and Pauper a lot, I did lead those formats for about a year, and that's when I found pre-modern. But I remember watching the brew one, and I was like, I mean, I thought the idea was interesting, but then once I realized they weren't too competitive, like, I kind of, like, was like, okay, I'm not sure if that's what PSS is about, because I wasn't even sure about the first one. But I think Mike Hoy asked for, like, feedback and stuff after the second one, and, like, from the community. And I was newer to the format, but, you know, the spike in me was, you know, like, hey, I would make this thing, like, very competitive. Even though the players in it were really good, I mean, I knew that they were like people that finished well in the monthlies and stuff. So that's what I was hearing from other people. So it wasn't that. I was just saying the decks themselves. So I was like,
exactly.
I would make it very competitive. That's what I want to watch. I was thinking back to the Vintage Super League. Like, that's something I would love to watch. I didn't even think I'd be participating.
Right.
Then I believe I like got to talk with Mike and Flint like a little bit, and I think they like saw like, oh, okay, like I'd be true, that's this guy, you know, that was like, he was a moto grinder, and like, so I'm not sure if that's really what threw me into it, and then having some good results when I first started playing pre-modern. But I was asked to play in the third one, and then I got top four in that one, then and I brought horrible decks. I'm not even gonna go into it. I was not prepared for like the band structure. Like, I was unprepared for the first one. The second one, I definitely put more thought into it. And then I made the finals and lost against Rich. Parfait versus Sly. So Parfait gave me the exit again from the PSS. I'm a little disgruntled about, especially this year.
We'll get to that one in a second.
And then they asked me back for the fifth one. I actually didn't think I was going to get the invite back. But I can't thank Mike and Flint enough for inviting me back. I don't know what it will take for me to get back onto a fourth one. If they don't pick me, like, I totally understand. Like, okay, do we want to see the same face four times in a row? I wouldn't want to see myself four times in a row. But, you know, if they do, they do. But if not, I look forward to watching it, because I think the past couple have been competitive, and that's really what drives me. I do like the brews and stuff, but I would like watch every minute of competitive play.
Exactly.
But yeah, that's hopefully that summed up. It wasn't too long-winded.
Oh God, no, not at all. You can talk all you want. And Dan, please turn that down. Oh, buddy, I could hear it. Anyway, I'm back. For those of you watching in my videos, short aside, you see little edits in there and things and weird cuts. That's because I have children. They run around. They're noisy. They're in the frame. So don't pay attention to any of that. And, you know, keeps them in line by knowing they're on camera. But coming back to where we are, so you've been invited back. You've top forward each of the ones you did, including this one. With this one, it was like, did you come into this with the intent of, like, a good-natured, even being good-natured of being, I want the pedigree of winning a PSS? Is there anything to wanting that pedigree as a person who is definitely more on a, spiky end.
I wanted to win this one so bad. Because, yeah, losing to the finals last year, and I picked the wrong band with Rich, and I was stuck with that Parfait versus Sly. Even though I stole a game. I stole a game against it, which, I remember when that happened, like, I felt confident I could win that matchup, but it mm-hmm. had to go in a certain situation, and Game 2 did, and then Game 3 obviously just didn't. But, you know, you had to get extremely lucky, but there was a game plan involved, and it went exactly that way in Game 2. But I wanted to win all of them, but this one really hit hard because I think when we found out after Week 1, Tax was banned. It's not – and, you know, Flint and Mike had no control over this.
Right.
So, but like, you know, I was in favor of, like, hey, maybe we should start over. And I understand the work that Mike and Flint put in is, you know, like, it's a lot of work. So I knew, like, I have no – I don't have to wait, you know, put any time into, like, doing the logistical behind-the-scene work. So for me, it was nothing. But for them, I was like, all right, I get why this is going to be a lot of work, and I totally understand. But I really did not want to keep playing against Parfait. I just didn't, even though I felt like my lineup was catered pretty good towards it, because I expected 2 to 3 players to bring Parfait, especially Rich. So I kind of prepared for that, but yeah, I mean, I went in, I really, really wanted to win, and but second thing I wanted to do was really just put on, like, I tried to play the best I could for the viewing experience, because I know I've been actually hearing from a lot of people, and people that reached out to me from Legacy or you know, people I knew from Magic Online, they've said like, hey, you know, I saw the PSS on Twitter or Facebook, or you know, I've been watching this on YouTube on Cloud Go Rangers channel. You know, this is like a way, it seems like people are getting into Premodern now for like in the beginning, they're watching PSS, so either live or the VODs. So like my second thing was, okay, you know, Tom, let's play the best and tight and sequence your lines as tight as you can for that viewing experience, because that's what I would want to see if I was in it. So I tried to do that and as much as I could, but
exactly,
yeah, there's like the two big focuses.
And I think you did amazingly well with that, and we'll get into these matches as we get farther in, but going back to facing the Parfait, on the note, I think with that match against Rich, putting that on camera, as a person who plays Sly, that you, the way you handled that match, and I'm going to ask him, may or may not have influenced how Flint then approached his Parfait beating Sly lists. The low curve, the, you know, using your lands as resources and finding a way to just stay under attack so they can't take advantage of that. So I think, and I will ask, if it did not pave the way, it certainly showed a game plan on how you could try and fight that red deck crushing of a deck. So we have to give you the props for that. And then, so you are correct. I went back and looked, because in my other ones, I couldn't remember if it was after week one or right before week one when land tax got banned. I couldn't remember the conversation. But so, yeah, I think you're absolutely right that even though I was also sick of playing against land tax, and I actually didn't have to do it this time, which is, well, probably actually bad for me. But I can't fault Flint or Mike for it, because, you know, they've already have things put together. It was a last hurrah, and we actually got to see, I think as a positive, is we got to see the land tax decks, but at least in the top bits of it, like, they weren't that amazingly successful. They got beat as much as they won, if not more. I think that showed that strategies were in place to fight them. So that's where I came from for it, at least. But our big next question was the system in which we were working with. Because you'd been in these, you'd seen the ban system. Everybody went into this probably initially thinking there was going to be a ban system again this year. So what was your thought once you heard there's going to be a rotation system, and how did that influence you deciding decks?
Yeah, I liked it. I think after PSS4, when they asked for some feedback from the players, I think I voted to change it up. And my suggestion was everyone brings a different deck each week. And I believe Mike said the difficulty there would be if someone doesn't have enough decks, right? So, okay, totally get it. But, I mean, I don't know. I think a lot of players... I haven't played the monthlies in a while just with work and stuff, but a lot of people play different decks all the time. So I was like, I don't know. Or that's just one of the questions you have to ask the person. If we're going to go with, you have to bring a different deck every week, can you do this? So, yeah. And it's not like you can bring blue-red Stifelknot, blue-white Stifelknot, mono-blue Stifelknot. That's one archetype, right? So, like, only one pick each time. And that was my suggestion, because I was like, I would love to see random deck, like, Replenish versus Elves, and then Slot, and then, like, but you get to see a bunch of them showcased, because a lot of them are going to be intertwined between which players pick which decks each week.
Exactly. But
also, a lot of back-end work there, I think, too. But I would suggest that again, like, if they were going to do it, I would, I mean, again, I don't know all the work that goes into it, but that would be my suggestion again, is a different deck every week, and you can't repeat decks the entire time. Even after the seven rounds, top four, you play different decks.
Absolutely. I like that idea. I think you can get around it. So there's always this debate about, should it be gold border? Should it just be all frame or whatever, proxy friendly? For something like this, if it went that way, like, as long as there was a caveat, like, as long as you had clearly printed playtest cards that somewhere said proxy on them, so there can nowhere be any mistaken, like, this is not a real card, but can be visible, I think that would work and solve the issue. Because this is really more about the gameplay, not how big is my collection.
Right.
It's like, how is the game, the gameplay. So I could see that. But yeah, definitely something I want to get into also with Mike and Flint when I get a chance to talk to them, hopefully, here in the future. It's like, what are thoughts going forward, if you have any? But so with this system being in place, we have to rotate it. How did that influence you picking the decks that you did?
Actually, yeah, not too much, because I felt like seasons 3 and 4, the ban system, to me, the reason I didn't like it, was it created like a sub game, in my opinion, where we're trying to figure out what you're going to ban, and then you could get punished. It wasn't my cup of tea. I rather more just, you know, GP style deck versus, you know, random deck versus random deck, and not have to worry about, well, if I ban this, then, you know, and they ban that. Like, I just didn't like that style. It's just not for me.
Sure.
But it was fine. But this one, I was actually more excited when I saw there was a change, because I wasn't a fan of it. And, but I will still kind of lean towards this one having some flaws where, yeah, like the deterministic game, your games on week 3 compared to week 1 and week 2 not being that way.
Yeah.
I felt as like one of the players, it was a little, like, anticlimactic, but I don't know. I stand by. I would love to see no repeat decks for any player, and I think it would be more. I think you'd get more diversity from it, and you would see some like fringe decks. If you could bring a different deck every week, I would bring some, interesting decks for sure.
Well, so Mike Arnold, as a side note, that would be interesting is Mike Arnold, for those who are not familiar, does his Super Gauntlet, right? Could you have a gauntlet of decks that everybody drafts somehow?
Ooh, that's a good one. Why not that? Why don't you draft the PSS?
That would be an interesting way to do that. And Mike Arnold already has like a system for it. I'm sure he could assist. So yeah, no, I think this format is like, I liken this to very much. A lot of people say this is based off kind of the vintage Super League it was, right? Was the name of the thing. To me, this, I never really watched that, but this reminds me of the old Magic Invitationals. Like, you're getting the, not necessarily like some sort of ranking system, people in here, and it's weird different formats. And, you know, maybe one, I would love to see things like maybe 1 week it's a no band series or something. Like, it'd be kind of cool to mix it up and do something interesting. But I think it was really fun putting this together as a first timer, without having to compare the two, and when I was picking my decks. So your decks, for those who are not familiar, if you haven't, go back, watch Cloud Goat Ranger, watch all the episodes or the videos, it's all there. But this is probably the most, I said this to Alvaro when I talked to him, but same goes for you. The most Tom series of decks I've ever seen in my life, for knowing you. Blue-white knot into land still, which is blue-white into the rock. Not only not natural lord rock, not dark rock or dark forest, but rage or rock. So were these just the decks that, like, these are almost... number one, you didn't bring Psychotog. I didn't bring Psychotog. I feel like we let people down somewhere.
We did.
But that's neither here nor there. Were you pretty, once you heard in, you were doing this, like, were you pretty locked on these three decks initially? Like, these just seem like your decks all around, decks you have been worked on and played. So there was no surprise to me seeing these. Is that probably an accurate statement?
It is. I learned over the past two PSS seasons, even though, you know, the ban structure change, or, you know, the way we're going to do bannings, or, you know, the way the season went, I still felt like I learned one thing, and anyone invited for the next one, take note of this, but land still, if you are good at and feel comfortable piloting land still, it's always a safe choice because it is really close in almost any matchup it has. So, yeah, I learned that in season four, I was like, okay, even though I lost some games with Landstill, I was like, this is always a safe bet, and it's one of my favorite decks to play. And also in a format like this, an enclosed one, the rock is really good, and you gain advantage from open deck lists with Cabal Therapy. And then the other one was Meddling Mage and Stifle Knot. Again, Gush is my favorite card of all time, and being able to play that, I was like, I have to play Gush. Like, Stifle Knot, it's fun too, and it's got some intricate lines, and it's something I just felt comfortable with all three of those, and I knew that all three of them were really good in like an enclosed open deck list meta, especially two decks with Meddling Mage and then one with Cabal Therapy. And I think when I sent in my list to Hoyp, I had the document titled Premodern Starter Pack or something.
I love it. It's absolutely awesome. So yeah, this looks like something you put together. You make a good point. Like, almost all the decks you picked out don't have very clear bad matchups in a lot of cases. They're very solid. They're very much decks that lend itself to the pilot knowing what they're doing and knowing what they're playing against. So I think you're absolutely correct about that.
Yeah, Flores would say, the Rock's the 46% matchup. But I mean, like, I do argue that. I still think Rock is... I think it's like Landing Rock is tier one. It's very good. It does struggle in some areas, but it's probably one of the best decks post board. It's just, it's so good at, it's very flexible. The cards you have to cut do not interrupt your game plan at all. It's a really good deck, and I think it's favored in more matchups than it's unfavored. So,
gotcha.
And then
that makes 100% sense.
Yeah, and the one thing with Stifle Knot is you can get free wins, like, you know, Dreadnought, just actually playing it the New York City 1.5K in the top eight against Dave Kaplan on Blue White Stifle Knot. He was on the play and just turned to Dreadnought. Like, that just happens. So, you know, that's honestly a big reason I think some people should migrate to a deck like that, where you can just get free wins like that. And when those things happen on turn two, you know, game one, you have a huge advantage. It's like when Dredge was the boogeyman in Vintage a couple years back, like, you win, you know, 90% of your game ones. And I think Dreadnought is really close to that. It wins a lot of game ones. I don't think it's as high as Dredge, but it wins a lot of game ones, like probably 70%. Fran would know more. I mean, that's like, he just can play that deck with his eyes closed. But, it's high for sure.
Absolutely. And then speaking, before we jump into the matches here, how did it feel to have kind of like the Cabal together? It's what it is essentially right now. It's a pre-modern Cabal. It's yourself and Lanny and Flores and whoever else has joined in. But you had this great cast of characters bouncing ideas off of and looking at these matchups. Did that feel different than previous PSSs where maybe still talk to people, but maybe rocked a little less, little more solo? Or was there definitely a team element to this one as far as your preparation?
A little bit, but not too much. Especially when Lanny joined. Yeah, we kind of, because I actually was picking Lanny's brain before he was invited. I was like, hey, I can't tell you what this is for, but you had to pick three decks. And he was like, wait a minute. He's like, what are you saying? And I was like, I'm not saying anything. I'm just asking you a question.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he kind of thought he knew what was going on, but I did not break the ice to him. I just continued to like play dumb a little bit. But once he was invited in, I just like, I think we were talking about him and I was just like, hey, like, you know, we both want to win and we'll ask each other some random questions just about like, what about this card or that card? But we didn't really bounce too many ideas off each other once he was invited in, because I think we both have that competitive nature where like, we're also going against each other, but it would be cool. Like, hey, with, you know, if we can play our match in person, which didn't get to happen, but each week just kept sneaking up on us, honestly. And I can't believe it's already over. It just went so fast.
Mm-hmm. It really did. It really did.
But no, it was good. It was good bouncing ideas off of like Flores and stuff too. Like, obviously he just, you know, knows a lot about Magic and, he's got really good insight and it's been awesome getting to know him, you know. He's a great friend now, and it's just when you get to talk to your friends, like, well, like what we're doing now, right? Just friends talking about pre-modern, like, it's just amazing.
Exactly. I mean, there's no better friend. That's the reason I do this. Well, you know what? Strength, win the lottery, everything's gonna be okay, and then we'll just do pre-modern all day, every day. That's the plan.
One day.
One day. So let's jump into our matches. So week one, it was yourself versus Jeff White. You were on Stifle Knot. Jeff was on L's. And gosh darn, if I would feel worse if he wasn't the one who handed me a loss for his wins. But Jeff could not initially catch a break in this PSS at all. And that match was just... What are your reminiscences of that blue-white Stifle Knot Survival Elves match? I don't remember it being... I feel like Jeff just didn't hit any cylinders in that match. Or am I remembering wrong?
No, so Elves, I mean, Will, you probably know this from just like the Magic Online Society leagues, like Elves versus Stifle Knot. I know you've played that match. I think Elves is can be a slightly favored, but it's really close. But it was this... Yeah. But also that matchup can... flip the opposite way where it's not, and that's exactly what happened. He just kind of stumbled. Mm-hmm. I don't remember if he had the mulligan or not, but also shout out to Jeff, part of Bill's Mafia. Go Bills.
Mm. There it is.
So like, I remember him and I talking before that we played, and we're like, oh man, I wish we, you know, I wish we didn't have to do this, you know, like Bills fans, we stick together, man. We don't, you know,
right?
Yeah. So but you know, we stuck to like no hard feelings no matter what, and always be part of Bill's Mafia together, but
exactly.
I just remember that both matches were kind of lopsided, unfortunately. Or yeah, both games were kind of lopsided, and that can happen. Mm-hmm. I think it's either Dreadnought has the 90% win in random games and steals it, or it's 50-50. Mm-hmm. Elves usually isn't the one that's like just so far ahead. Yeah, just from the games I played, and I played that matchup a lot, so. I think I've lost more of them, honestly, but I, from the Dreadnought standpoint, but it just feels close, and you know, one slip up costs you.
Yeah, no, I would agree with that. So moving on to week two, and I've tried to go back in my memory and pick out moments and learning experiences. I certainly have them for myself. I have so many things that I learned, and I'm sorry if I'm looking away from the screens because I got the spreadsheet up on the. Other screen here, but week two you were up against Jared Doucette, the goblin patriarch whatever himself, also a great conversation, check that out. So what this match reminded me of, it was a great match, but then we got to game three, and do you remember we were playing in a top eight of a monthly? You were on blue red Knot, I was on Psychotog. And I made the mistake of, like, attacking and then before blockers gushing back all of my islands so you could block my Tog. And after that, I went full just tilt, just shouldn't have played the rest of the match. and it wasn't that bad, but it was kind of like I was looking at you, and you had made an error in game three. I think it was game three, and there was your daughter was in there. There was distraction, but you were very. I had never seen your demeanor change like that when I've played you and played with you. And there's no good way, I think, in my experience, to reach out to a person in that moment to like do anything to make it feel better. But how, in that situation, could you explain what happened and how it affected you, and how, as a player, in a high stress thing, even though this is a fun thing, it's stressful, we want to win. How do you make sure you recover from that and try and pull yourself back from that for the next match?
Yes. So I did want to talk about this. So I was kind of this is like the main area I was looking forward to speaking about. So I used to play, I played poker full time for about 12 years, and it's just not one of the things I felt comfortable doing once I started a family. So, found something like, you know, obviously just more structured and everything like that. But that taught me a lot about competitive Magic. I played Magic longer, but I learned from poker to keep. I'm very stoic all the time. Yep. I learned that from playing poker, even poker online. The focus was always there, and I always wanted to win, and very competitive, playing sports my whole life. Like, but poker, got me into this mindset of staying focused. And whoever's sitting across from you, either it's eight other players at the poker table or one across from you at Magic, your goal here is to win and beat them. And my stoic personality, I think, fit with that too. Plus, I'm very systematic. I shuffle the same amount of times almost every game, and I have weird kind of things I do like that. But yeah, so you bringing up me not losing my cool, I usually don't tilt. And I think I mentioned, first I want to give a shout-out to you and everyone that reached out to me after that game, because I did show it in my body language, which I can typically keep together. Even when I'm playing, I don't show emotion. I just don't let it happen. And because, again, my own goal is, I need to win. And I don't want to give any edges to my opponent, So when that happened, I completely just lost it. I don't even know how to explain it. It's almost like if I was sitting down trying to be diagnosed from a doctor and asked me what's going on, and I don't really know. Completely blanked out. I believe it was, my daughter walked in and I stepped away. When I got back, I just used deed for three, I just don't even recall what happened in the moment. And then after it happened, it was that split second. I just wait, what did I just do? And I was putting the cards in the graveyard. I was so confused. And, but I told myself internally, I'm not going to ask Jared to take it back. I didn't even say anything out loud to him. I just remember I was sighing and, a little bit I just was I'm taking this mistake and I'm going to learn from it, because it's impossible for a human to not make a mistake. And I kept telling myself that, but I was very upset because, as I mentioned earlier, the second thing I wanted to do was showcase each deck and every game I play to the best of my ability. And so people saying oh man, I love the rock. This format's so cool. Oh, that line was sick. I maybe wouldn't have done that. That seemed right in the moment. So people could pick up those kind of things, because I learned from watching people stream Magic and all that kind of stuff. So that's what really, really bothered me. It was obviously I wanted to win, and I told you whoever's sitting across from me, I want to win that game. But it was the second thing too. Both of them hit me hard, and I was I can't believe I just completely blanked out and I didn't know what just happened. And I can't recall that happening to me ever in another Magic game. It just it was really strange. But again, thank you to you, even Jared, after, and then later on, the next day he texted me, and a bunch of people reached out to me saying hey, got your back, don't let it bother you. And again, there's no stakes. It's just it's great when you have friends like that support you. And helped you through, because it was eating away at me. It was just for those two things specifically. I just made a huge mistake. I didn't want it to happen. And but yeah, I'd like to think that I did set it aside about 24 hours later, and then I moved on. But it just shows how passionate, like, you know, we are about this format in particular, where like that affected me for two specific reasons. And you know, just like we really care about this hobby and this game, and yeah, it meant a lot. But yeah, I was luckily able to move on. I don't tilt. I'm sticking with it. I mean, I did there, so I can't say that I don't anymore. But I will try to not in the future, and I haven't tilted since. But
yeah, and there's nothing to be wrong with that. Like, I mean, that happens. As you said, humans are not perfect. You're usually very stoic. And it wasn't like you were throwing cars on the table. It was just you, like, it was for me watching and others watching. It was just a noticeable, like, that doesn't look like Tom for a second. And so, yeah, no, I'm glad that you were able to move forward. And we'll kind of talk a little bit about that more when we get to our match. Because I had something similar that we had initially had a plan to go over our match on video. But I think too long has passed now and I can't remember details as far as what I was thinking. Yeah. But there's one specific moment in there I want to talk about that leads into this point when we get there. But you had a hard-fought game against Jared. And it's a classic matchup, in my opinion. It's Rock versus Goblins, real tight. Who hits a ringleader? Who gets a deed? Who has plagues? And outside of that one moment, I think it was a well-played match. I do remember games one and game two. I think one was lopsided in your favor, one was lopsided in his favor, and then game three was this banger of a match where numerous times I was like, oh, Tom can't lose. And then, oh, Jared can't lose. Here's a top deck. It was a crazy match to watch, and it was awesome, including what happened, because the game still wasn't even over after that point. There was still play going on.
Yes.
So that was a sight to see. So shout out to you and him for a great match. If you're looking for a primer on that match, go try and find Jared Doucette versus Tom Metelsky from PSS5. Watch it. It'll give you a good idea how that match goes and what's important. Moving on to week three, you had the pleasure of playing against Mr. Rich Shea in a Landstill versus a Red-Green Goblins match. What do you remember about this match?
So, yeah, it's another close one, but I prepared the Landstill sideboard. Actually, when we were working on it for LobsterCon, me and Mike Flores, you need to run so many Hydro Blasts for Sly and Goblins. I think Landstill's favored post-board because you get swords 5 through 8, you know, depending on how many Hydro Blasts you run. But yeah, I think that one wasn't close either. I think game one I had the swords for Lackey, I think. I'm like the worst at like going back and thinking about the matchups. But
it's all right. It's all right.
But I remember after that game, he was, you know, Rich was a little... And me and Rich go back a ways. Like, we've known each other now, I don't know, maybe 15 years, something like that. And, like, from the, you know, the vintage and legacy competitive scene. So, but now we're, you know, we became great friends from that. But, yeah, so that's why, like, you know, I feel like, you know, him and I, we could, you know, we were able to talk, you know, more personally about, like, how we felt the matchup went and stuff like that. And, like, I just remember him being a little, you know, disappointed, like, how does this deck win games kind of thing? And Goblins can stumble. Like, it's just...
Yeah. Was that the match where... Because Rich didn't have great success with Goblins in this PSS. Was that the match he just stumbled on mana? Like, he just couldn't hit a land drop in one of those games? Or was that a later match? I can't remember which one that was.
I think against me, he, like, was completely flooded, I believe. And then I resolved... Okay. Oh, and I think I resolved Humility.
Okay,
and
that'll do it.
Yeah, it was just one of those games where the Goblins deck became too slow at that point. Oh, and he did not see it naturalized. I think he had access to 4 post-board, but he just didn't see it.
Okay, got ya. Okay, that makes sense. So at this point, heading into week 4, you are 2-1, feeling pretty good. So week 4, you are up against Lanny, Burning Parfait versus The Rock. And... Lanny is, I've had a chance to talk to him a little bit, but just listening to him talk, he's so animated and he's so like, how did this happen? What's going on? And it's this, it's really fun to hear him talk about it. And I couldn't wait to hear their podcast. Shout out to the Spike Conley afterwards to have him talk about it, because there was a, was it a series of like two top decks? What, like there was a series of things that ended with like a top, either a top deck or a played pernicious deed that just like made everything go boom. And you could see Lanny's hands just go like that. Talk to me about that match, because I know you guys obviously are now very good friends. You work together. What was that experience like?
Yeah, it was awesome. I actually had the feeling, I'm pretty sure that we could pick decks, and I knew he was going to... So Lanny knows, or, well, I guess we can talk now. Lanny knew I hated Lantax. Parfait. I mean, not... I just hate the Parfait deck. It's not really Lantax itself. He knew I hated Parfait, and I had that feeling. I was like, he's going to play Parfait against me when he gets that chance. Like, he's going to do it. One, because he's very good at piling the deck, and then two, he knows I hate it, and maybe he can get in my head a little bit and, you know, get me off, like, my you know, what I'm trying to focus on.
Mm-hmm.
But that game where, so I was able to, I didn't really walk him into something, but I prepped for what that turn needed to look like if I was not going to lose, because he was going to trigger attacks, and I was going to lose that game. And mm-hmm. I cycled Croaks and Tusker. I think I drew a land, and I think I had another. No, I think I had Cabal Therapy in my hand. I Tusker, mm-hmm. drew a land. I untapped, and I draw Deed for turn. Now, mm-hmm. he shuffled in his one null. And we have open decklist. So I told all my opponents, I was like, hey, if I'm looking to my right, I have your decklist open on my phone.
Right.
But I guess a lot of people kept it open on their desktop. But like, it's my routine. I got my little setup. So like, I got my thing here. I got his decklist open. He's got one null. He shuffled it back in with the guy's blessing specifically for the deed. And I knew that's what it was for. I was like, okay, my only out here, though, is the deed. Because he had a bunch of permanents on board, and him triggering Lantax would have won the game because he had Scroll Wreck, too.
Mm-hmm.
I got lucky, and I drew. So, yeah, I didn't draw the deed off the Tusker. Like I said, I drew it. I just ripped it for turn. But Tusker got me there. And mm-hmm. I had the Cabal Therapy in my hand. So at that point, I knew he... I'm going to force, so I was... Oh, and I had to flashback... Oh, no, I did not have therapy in my hand, actually. I'm going to take that back. Sorry, this is why I'm horrible at this. But...
It's okay, so don't worry.
Yeah, I think I had no cards in hand except for Tusker. I cycled Tusker,
mm-hmm.
drew the land, untap, draw deed. I have therapy and Call of the Herd in my graveyard. He's got one mana open. So I was like, I either need to get the null out of his hands, and I had just enough mana to flashback the Call of the Herd, or I could have just cast deed into, like, you know, naked into what he could have redrawn that null, because he drew, mm-hmm. I think, a card to, like, since he shuffled it back in. And I'm playing the odds here, like, I'm like, all right, you know, even though it's a low chance, I'm not taking that risk, and I wanted to stick to my premise, and like I usually do when I play, like, take the best line if the opportunity allows you to do so, which it did. Mm-hmm. So I was like, I'm not losing too much value by fleshing back this Call of the Herd. Because if I wipe his board here, my top decks are much better than his. Because at this point, he was also, he only had one card in his hand. So
mm-hmm.
His best top decks at that point after I sweep the board would be Oath. So I knew, okay. I took a little time, and I was like, you know, this is like a top eight of a pro tour. We can take the time here. There's no clock. As long as I don't get called out for slow playing, I'm taking my time.
Mm-hmm.
I realized, I was like, I can flashback Call of the Herd, use therapy, make him, you know, scroll back at that point to hide whatever he had, or show me he doesn't have a null.
Mm-hmm.
So he does it. He taps his last mana. He puts card back, draws a card. I know at that point it's safe to deed, so I deed the board. And Cabal Therapy is still on the stat. I call Cabal Therapy after he scroll racked. I was like, okay, null is not a concern anymore. I can now Cabal Therapy the worst card I would want him to have with his Oath of Druids. I hit the Oath of Druids in his hand because I was like, that's what I lose to. And he discards the Oath while I wipe the board. It was all value for me. There's no way he came back from that. He almost did, actually, which is kind of surprising. I remember thinking to myself, what the hell is going on right now? Because the way I pictured it and took those several turns beforehand was the setup for mm-hmm. this. Like, if I draw deed, I can do this play. And I kind of had that lined up. When he shuffled the annul in, I was like, oh, no, now I have to play around that. Like, I can't I can't just play the naked deed if I draw it. So luckily it lined up in my favor. I was kind of happy with myself for preparing for that turn. And yeah, I was actually more proud of myself for naming, because like if I trap him to tapping out and the one card I lose to is Oath, I have to name Oath to the therapy. I was more proud of myself for the therapy play than I was actually for like the deed line, because the deed line would have to happen regardless. Like if I don't do it, I lose. But
right.
The therapy set up to get the Oath out of his hand, which he did draw. I got so far ahead. I mean, he just was, you know, because like we know Parfait has the deck is all air basically.
Yeah.
But when it has its engine going, that's where it can't be beaten. So, as you know, like that's just the way it goes, and you know why rightfully got banned is just something like along those lines. But oh man, yeah, that's gonna be pumped up. And it was just like you said, Lanny's so animated, like he was egging me on, like calling me out, and I'm like, I remember he was like talking and doing this with his hands, and I didn't say a word. I was locked in, Will, man. I was locked in. I was like, Lanny,
I love it. What was shared as soon as it happened, though? Like, you both getting the deed and hitting the Oath. Like, what was his, like, was he just stunned into silence?
Silence.
It was just silence?
Yeah.
Oh, that was something to watch. I wish I could have been a fly on the wall. And Lanny, I love you to death, but God, that was fucking brutal. It's just funny, so like, brutal.
He's, you know, we've become so close. Like, I think Lanny, we talk every day, and, you know, I just know, like, if it was the other way around, too, like, if I was egging him on, I would have became silent, too. But Lanny, he gave me complete props. Like, he was just like, that was, like, I think a couple turns have passed, or at the end, he was like, that was, like, really well done. Yep. And
absolutely. So
he's gotten me before too, so I was like, all right, come on, man, we're even.
I love it yeah. Absolutely. So we have a great matchup against Lanny. See, we move into week five, sitting at 3-1. We play week five in, I don't know, one hell of a match, honestly. At least it felt that way. It was long, it was hard, my brain hurt at the end of it. What were your memories of that match?
You were the one opponent I was fearing the most, because I know how well you play Stasis, and I also knew you know I don't like Stasis.
So you love Stasis. You absolutely love it.
I like the idea, like you know, Turtle Man Gerard. Like every deck he loves, I love. Like, whenever I think of Stasis too, I just know he's an advocate and a lover of Stasis. So, and I know you do too, but like I was just like, I don't want to hate it. Like I want to like Stasis because like, you know, my friends like it. But I knew you, just like Lanny, that you had, like, you knew inside your head, like, he hates this deck so much. Like, come on, tell me the truth. Well, did you play it because it was me?
Kind of. And then also, like, you had Meddling Mages in your other stuff, and I couldn't play Fluctuator against you. So, but no, I definitely knew what you were going to be on, because I don't think – so to talk a little bit about the matchup is with Fluctuator. So I picked Fluctuator, and I can talk about this more whenever I get into talking about my stuff is I picked Fluctuator because I knew it was a good deck. I didn't have the confidence to play it or the reps well. So I was using it as a, like, wagging a big old stick in people's faces. Like, you can't do this because I have this. So then I know what you bring in. So I did not, the way that went is I knew that you could not bring land still against Stasis. Like, there was no way you were going to do that to yourself.
I think
so it's like he's on Dreadnought.
It's land still's worth matchup, I think.
Yeah, so it's like he's on Dreadnought. And there's a difference here from a Stasis perspective is back before blue white, the mono blue Stasis, and I played this matchup a bunch against Rich when we would play. He'd be on mono blue, I would be on Stasis. And this is where a lot of, I know it's not the first thing to happen, where a lot of our revamping came from with the brain freeze sideboard is he learned, and we learned through that testing, is that game almost never relies on Dreadnought winning unless it's early. There's just too much Stasis can do to screw it up. So there needs to be an alternate game plan. And it started with Rich doing, okay, I'm going to use my vision charms to get ahead on cards, because eventually we're going to go that way and fight a big counter war and whatnot. So eventually it came that, and then it came into brain freeze. So that's where the brain freezes initially came from. And once I added brain freezes to stasis, I didn't think I could, if the dreadnought player did not have brain freeze, I did not feel I could lose that matchup in the slightest. It's just too few threats, too many things I can do. That's fine. Blue-white changed it. Meddling Mage, for people who don't understand the power of Meddling Mage, and I'll just use this, is it's insane. It flips that matchup on its head. I can't take time because it means you can shut off an important card and have a beater, which Stasis already doesn't like to do early. And one of the cards you shut off, and you are doing it correct, and everybody should be doing this, is when, in most cases, if you're playing Meddling Mage, you should be naming Chain of Vapor, not Stasis. Don't name Stasis, usually, but name Chain of Vapor, because that way I'm at, like, my deck's a little different because I had one Boomerang and I also have Claws of Gix, so I can kind of get around it, but it makes it a lot harder. And we saw that in both game. We saw that in almost every game where that would come up. So you were right. I did pick it to bring it back home. I did pick it because you and I knew you loved it, but I also picked it because it was the only choice I could make.
All right.
And I think game one was so... I remember it being so close. I can't remember a mistake being made on either side. What were your thoughts kind of game one?
I think game one was one of the better ones. I think we probably both felt the same way. Like, whoever loses this game is losing one that was played well from both ends. It's just kind of like, almost like... Because I felt that way. I was like, if I... Like, yeah, because what game one is... I won that one, right?
No, I won game one, but that's because what I think...
Yes.
Yeah, I topped... I think I had to top deck or get good draws in, like, the last two, and I think you had to miss on a turn to just keep the Black Vice count high.
No, I remember now, yes, because I specifically was like I remember like going into the sideboard and it felt like it was like a gut punch where like I was so close, but I did feel like you outplayed me like to get that game. Like whoever was gonna outplay that person was winning that game and like got me. Like that was where I was like I didn't think I was gonna win the match, honestly, after, because I was like, game one is so important.
Yep. And then game two, I think you drew like, was it two Meddling Majors or something in succession, and I just can't recover from that.
I remember game two not being relatively close.
It was not. It didn't feel great for me. So game three is the one that was interesting. So I was on the brain freeze plan. I think I mulliganed, and then my second hand had both of my brain freezes in it. The plan was just to play a long game, you know, take some Meddling Mage beats, whatever, and I can get through it and get enough point to get there. I made a mistake at one point. Is I think you didn't really have much going on. I think I had countered a Meddling Mage. There was no action on the board, and eventually you went for a Dreadnought, like turn five or six, something like that. And I remember mana shorting you in response. So I was at 20 life. That was a mistake. No, and the reason it was a mistake is I think that my hand, it was at least two brain freezes. I think another like cheap counterspell or free counterspell and like a gush or two. Like I had a pretty good hand. And if I just took the time to do the math right, like there was a turn where I mana sharded me at a counter fight and it left me short one mana to brain freeze you once and force a brain freeze. I was short by like a mana to brain freeze you at the end of the turn, which meant it was a wasted resource of turns. There was no reason to do that. Whereas what I was supposed to do, in theory, is, okay, he lands a Dreadnought. I'm still fully stocked, right? I can take a hit from the Dreadnought. Cool. Then mana short you end of turn. See if you fight. And I don't know how fast you would have fought over a mana short or what it was. But even if you did... I think I have a way where even if you leave a stifle up, I have enough mana and enough resources because by that point I could have played another land. And I eventually ended up drawing Chains of Vapor because that game went on decently long because I kept finding chains. I would have had enough time to do enough spells through gushes and other things to brain freeze you. And even if you had the stifle for the first brain freeze, the second brain freeze would have got you. So I just went too early. And I remember as soon as I cast that mana short and looked at my mana, I was like, I'm going to lose this game. And I don't know what your recollection of that game was or what you were thinking about. What were your thoughts kind of in that last game?
Yeah, I remember, like, because now it's coming back to me a little, where after I lost game one, the other reason I felt like that was such a gut punch is now I have to deal with the brain freeze. So melee mage has become more important of, like, naming the right card in the right situation. And I had to play around brain freeze. So I had to be careful of how many spells I was doing. So it's awkward because I got to try to win fast, but it doesn't, if you play slow, Dreadnought doesn't necessarily have to win fast in that matchup.
Sure. Exactly.
So it's kind of,
I would agree.
Right. It's kind of weird who becomes the control deck. And, I think Dreadnought takes over because you're going to try to win with Brain Freeze and Black Vice, right?
Yeah, a lot of times in that matchup, I incorrectly brought out a couple of either one, like a couple of Stasises and like maybe a Black Vice, because they're just really not that effective in that matchup. Wait, yeah, they're really not.
Yeah, Stasis is not, like, that's not the card you fear. Like, in certain situations, you might have to Meddling Mage a Stasis, but, like, it doesn't really matter too much.
Right, right. So, I mean, that's what I would do, and it's just, I wish I had playtested the match more, and I was going off assumptions that it played more like Blue Knot, and I felt more comfortable than I should have been, but either way, I think it was a wonderful match, and if people want to go and take a look at an interesting match, that's one as far as who's a control, who's a beatdown, when are you making a move, patience. So yeah, definitely do that. But you picked up that win, so you're now at 4-1, I believe, because your only loss at that point had been to Jared. So going into week number 6, it was yourself versus Alvaro in another great, like, you had a lot of great matches in this PSS that I remember just being just grossly, like, intrigued by. Like, that, the Welder matchup, because Alvaro was on Welder stacks, you were on Landsteel. What was your thought on that matchup?
Yeah, I'm trying to think back to that one, because him and I talked about it a while. He's a great friend. Yeah, we were the starters of the
Shrimp Team, Shrimp Gang.
Yeah, man. So yeah. Him and Chef to spend lots. Still talk to them on a daily basis, too. We were always knocking around ideas about, and it's not even about Mono Blue anymore, because I think we kind of know that situation. Even though they both are more, I was just invited to the party. They're the creators of it. Yeah, I was just there kind of like, you know, having a good time and, taking in, like, you know, good information from them. But I remember, I think Landsteel is favored. And okay. I think we talked about it post game where if Landsteel stumbles at all on land, which I think happened game 2 or 3, Landsteel can't.
I think it might have been game 3, because it felt like he just really got, like, I think you stumbled and he got a really, really quick, like, winter orb that game. I think it was a winter orb.
Yeah,
he played that game, and then he fouled it real quick.
Yeah, he played really well. He knew the matchup, and I knew he had the rep to him. I've never played that matchup. It was, like, you know, like, anecdotal for me to think that Landsteel's favored. I think he agreed with it slightly. It's really close. But I know he's played that matchup. Like, he played that deck a bunch. He knows it. So that was one worry about myself going in. I knew he was, you know, he's just, you know, like everyone that was in the PSS, he's very good, and he knows this deck. And it's also difficult when you're sitting on the other side of it where you don't know this matchup. And I was just going off of, like, his list. Like, I kept looking at his list just thinking, what do I need to worry about? Which is a lot of different cards. But Landsteel is well-equipped to, like, deal with a wide variety of threats. It's, you know, really good counter one-for-one kind of deck, like, you know. So, but yeah, I definitely stumbled game 3. I think what happened was I didn't draw a land. I'm pretty sure that's what happened. I got stuck on 3.
I feel like you missed a land drop or 2 in succession is what I remember. And he just had some time to lock it up. But so with the way the PSS was, after that matchup, a hard-fought matchup, you were at 4-2. Was 4-2 actually locked at that point, or did some of the math say that if it went bad, it could mean you don't make it? Because the math was real funky. There was a lot of, outside of myself and Jeff, unfortunately, there was a lot of clumping. Nobody ran away really with everything.
Now, I remember I was the first one to jump in with into the group before the last week, and I was like, all right, I'm going to take the time and try to crunch these numbers and figure it out. And I really did. I gave it a lot of thought. I enjoy, you know, math, and so I was like, I got this. I want to put myself to the test and see if I can figure this out. Well, that didn't happen. So I reached out to two people smarter than me. So I reached out to Inagi and Gabe, another Bills Mafia fan. Go Bill.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I was like, hey guys, I need you to do this. They just were like, hey, like, not enough of a turnaround here. So then I think Lanny, once I told the group, I was like, I give up. Lanny was like, all right, let me do this. So Lanny took over, got it done. And I think there was like some, I think he figured it all out by time we went into it. But we didn't think I was a lock, but it ended up being Jared and myself were locked, I think, no matter what.
Yep.
That's what ended up happening. But I was going into it thinking, no, we only thought Jared was. But so, yeah. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, Lanny had that situation where he still owes me. I don't know what he's going to get me. But because Mike Arnold was trying to
play spoiler.
Yeah, yeah, I'll just jump into it. He was trying to give me – he was offering me a Lion's Eye Diamond and
– he was trying to line the pockets a little bit.
Of course, yeah.
Absolutely.
Which love Mike Arnold. He's awesome. Mm-hmm. We got a good laugh after that. He's, you know, he's like, "What do you like?" He's like, "This one's the near mint. This one's LP." Lanny had one. There was a 1-16 chance with all the wins and losses lining up that Lanny would not make top eight, and it came down to me and Mike Arnold's match where all of the stuff happened. Where if Lanny, if I lose Mike Arnold. Mike Arnold gets in and Lanny's out.
And this is a classic example of, because I was commentating this matchup. I think I got pulled into commentary at some point because Lanny, sweet child of himself, had to go to bed or something. this is a classic example of playing to ounce and not giving up. Because you and Mike had a great set of games. It went to a game three. And there was a situation where I cannot remember the exact situation of it. One second. Yes?
Can you please quiet down?
Then go sleep. I'll do my best. I'm back. there was a situation in which it looked, I cannot remember what Mike Arnold did, but it looked like he could not lose. And then I think I remember thinking the only way – I remember saying something like, if somebody's going to win this match, Tom's going to figure out a way to win this match. And this was a match where I think you ended up like gushing to Armageddon to resolving a dreadnought. Is that reminding you of anything? Because I remember everybody in the chat was saying there's no way Tom comes back from what had happened. I can't remember exactly what happened. But you had ended up finding it, Armageddoning, and winning. Can you replay any of that for us?
Yes. So, I don't remember the exact situation I was in, but I remember, like, I know the Rock matchup versus Dreadnought, especially with Dreadnought adopting Armageddon. And you only need one because you can cycle, like, you're a Xerox deck. You can find your one of. It's like, I'm obsessed with playing Delver. So, like, that's all mm-hmm. I do in Legacy. And in Delver or, you know, Dreadnought, these Xerox decks, you can run your one of not hate cards. Like, what do you call it? Like
your answers, your one of answers.
Yeah, like the catch-all answer. Like your one of Null Rod or your Haymaker. So
So
one Null Rod or one Armageddon, the deck. The card that will shut down specifically what, like, if you're going against an all artifact deck like Mud or something or Devour, mm-hmm. and you find the one Null Rod, you can do that in Xerox decks because your deck's equipped enough where it can just win the game on its own game plan, which Dreadnought can do against the Rock, or can filter through your deck and find the Haymaker. So I knew, like, I know this matchup from both sides. I was like, all right, so the one arm again, this is exactly what it's for. It's for the Rock and it's for landstill control and mid range. The games after post board are going to revolve around this. So, I can't remember exactly what it was when he got so far ahead, but I just told myself, I was like, you know how you can get back into this, and it's going to involve Gush and cycling through your deck to find that Armageddon. And then obviously being able to put pressure on him quickly. So, yeah, I wish I remember exactly what happened. I remember watching the VOD back and I was like, like the Armageddon play, you're like, oh God, he's doing it.
Yeah. I as soon as you did, it was like, okay, he found it. And I think Mike, to fairness to Mike, it wasn't like there was much he could do about it. Mike got a little unlucky too, because I think he was like, there was this weird stalemate. You weren't doing anything. He took care of threats. And Mike was just like, I can't find anything to play. I think he was just flooding on lands and he was just like, what am I going to do? The only thing I would say is I think he kept playing Outlands, which was the thing I was in my mind, was I thought you were digging for Armageddon and he kept playing Outlands. If you can't do anything with the lands, I'm not sure what playing out the lands did. Because if it was me, my thought would have been like, if I know Armageddon's there, like, and I don't need these lands, I'm going to hold it in case he finds Armageddon. Because I think what it was is, like, it wasn't all in one turn. It was a Gush, Armageddon, play land for the turn, Mike Arnold, no land drop, you land for the turn, and maybe one more turn went by before you put out the Dreadnought again. And I think it was a situation of Mike just didn't have any more lands in the hand because he kept playing them out. I would have to check with him and look it back, but I think you guys talked about it afterwards. But it was an example of that game looked very bleak for you, but you kept going for your out. And I think that's a valuable lesson we could take away from PSS or something like that, is play for an out. If you're not losing and there's no time, don't concede. Like, if you have an out, play for it. Is that your general mindset as you were kind of in that position and moving forward?
Yeah, and again, I stuck to, like, this game's not over because I knew how I had to get out of it. And again, you have to sequence correctly and draw the right cards, but my hand was pretty loaded because the whole game three I was just sculpting my hand for this instance where he's got the quick natural order or threats where I have to catch up. And I thought he would have boarded all the natural orders, but then when I realized he didn't, because it's just so bad against daze or counterspell, when he didn't, I was like, okay, well, his rock just specifically is structured around natural order, so he probably can't cut all of them. So once I realized he kept them in, I was like, this does make sense.
Yeah.
So yeah, he just can't.
That caught you game two.
Right.
Yeah, that's how he got you game two. Like, he just caught you off guard with it and you couldn't catch up. But yeah, no, it was a sight to see, both well played. So you end up picking up the win and you're on to the top four. At any point during this, I know we talked a little bit and I talked about it, but like, once you reach the top four, did nerves start setting in at all, or were you cool and breezy? Everything okay? Like, where were you at once you reached top four?
No nerves.
Nice.
Yeah, it's just, I, like, sometimes I will feel, like, you know, the sweat in my palms a little where, you know, okay, like, this game's getting tight. But as I mentioned earlier, there's something I just, like, I have this competitive drive where I will not let it happen. I won't let something that I can control get in the way. So, to the best that I can, it's sometimes you just can't, like, you know, but, that's what's so great about Magic. Mm-hmm. Like, their variance is great, but there's a lot of, like, you make the decisions and then you can make the decisions based off what your opponent does and you can plan turns ahead. Like, this is probably why we're still playing. I mean, this game is so addicting. Especially pre-modern, the era of just, like, you know, you don't have to worry about, like, this crazy haymaker top deck like you do now, in my current, you know, Magic, where the creatures aren't that powerful where you just cast it and lose the game on sight, you know? So, I was nervous. I was prepared, and I actually had more of a drive to want to win because it was my revenge against Rich where he beat me in the finals last year. And I was really looking forward to it because I knew he was going to give it his all too because I know how bad he wants to win. So, but yeah, I will never let that bother me.
That's good.
Told myself that from years ago, and I won't let it happen. Even if I feel creeping up a little bit, Will, nah, man.
Yeah.
Got to shut it down.
I got to learn that lesson because it kills me every time. I can't do it. So it's a lesson I'm learning, but we are in our top four.
Well, hold on. I like to say I got, you know, ice in my veins, right? But then I choke at the free throw line, so it's all good, you know.
Oh, that's okay.
That's what I do, Will. I choke at the free
throw. You don't choke. You won a monthly. You've top four to all the PSSs. Relax. You top four to your last event.
I choke.
Shh. Just don't eat salads. Don't eat salads on the – that's the only time you don't, like, make it to an event and do well in, from what I've seen. So you're against Rich in the top four. It is a revenge match. Boy, do you want to win. Talk to us about the match.
So,
while you begin talking, I'm going to get my water. I'm listening.
Actually, speaking of which, I'm not going to be too long-winded. So, I've done enough talking, but I will try to make it as short as possible. I was under the impression, and again. You know, I talked to Flores mainly about this and Fran because Lanny's still in it. I didn't want to – him and I didn't bounce too many ideas off each other. It's like we're not doing that. But I was like – I know Rich. Like I know Mike's known him for a long time too, but I was like, I know Rich. Like he's going to bring Parfait. He brings the deck he's comfortable with. And I thought he was going to do that actually in week 7. I was wrong. He brought Dreadnought, and that's just Rich being a genius. But I did not see that coming. I would have just got crushed also by him. But
Lanny was very sad.
But like the math, I guess, if you want to say math, lined up for Rich to bring goblins. I was like, no, he talked so bad about it with me, and then he did it another week. I just was like, there's no way it's gonna happen. And I was like, this is where Rich is really like in a. Move on to the final situation, and he's not playing Parfait probably ever again. I think I had that feeling. So, Dreadnought wasn't the pick for me, and it wasn't Landstill. Landstill's favorite. It's okay. Landstill really gained traction again when Parfait was running rampant, crushing. Even though it wasn't having the highest meta percentage, it was winning every tournament. You know, when people were paying attention, that's what it was doing. And, but I was like, I beat Rich with the Rock. I think I don't know if he's only lost to the Rock still against me once when he was on Parfait, but I played that matchup a lot on Magic Online and I felt comfortable. And I don't think like I maybe only lost one, like let's say I played it 20 times. Let's just call it 20. Only lost once. And it was like, The Rock also gained traction in that meta because it was really, in my opinion, would dominate Parfait. Like that, I think that was the worst matchup for Parfait was the Rock. And I was like, that's what I thought was going to happen. So that's why I went with the Rock. I think I didn't tell them what I was going to play, or maybe I did. And Flores was like, yo, what are you doing? You're crazy. Like, you know, cause he's like 40% or whatever. But I knew that I just had that gut feeling. And when Rich put me on Landstill, but he went, you know, when we realized what we were playing, I don't know if he at that point was like, oh no, like I think here we go again. And especially when I went up two games, but I dreaded something. I did worry about the post board because post board is where I've lost games versus Parfait. Even though I have a lot more hate cards, Rich's board specifically with Anduin Brushhopper and Armageddon were the two cards I was fearing. Android Brushhopper is like the worst creature for the Rock to deal with because right, you're 1-for-1 removal and they don't care. So, it's really strange and, it blocks well against all the things I have except for like a Baloth. But, Yeah, I mean, it can block sack. I knew all these things that Brush Hog was going to do. And I knew, like, I just knew that from the experience of playing that match. I was like, it's not in Rock's favor. I don't care what anybody said. I played those matches. Like, maybe people have different experiences, but that's how I felt. And, yeah, I was a little worried. Like, I was up 2-0. I felt good, but I was like, this is where I think things could go a little, get out of order from where I wanted them to go. Specifically, if he drew those cards, and he did. I think it was 3, 4, and 5. He saw the one or two Armageddons or both, and he got the Brush Hopper. But I think he even knew also he had to get a little lucky because the Rock lines up very well against what Parfait was doing. But once they land those threats, the Rock is completely on the back foot. And that's exactly what happened. Like, it was portrayed in all the games. Those matches played out specifically exactly how you would look at it. If you're looking at both decks on paper, that's what I would see, is what happened in all of them. And I think Parfait has to get a little lucky. They're a slightly favored post board because of those cards that the Rock has extreme trouble with, and they can filter through their deck with that broken engine. And the Rock really can't do that. You're just drawing a card every turn and hope that you are seeing the ones you need to see. So.
Yeah, there was a game. It was so weird too. This is another point of playing for outs and really thinking about it, which Rich is, I don't know, a better player of who thinks through what the right line is, right? Like, that's probably the most consistent thing you hear about Rich, is he knows and thinks about what that path is. Because there was a game where it's like he had Armageddoned you, but it was going so slowly that you had like 2 Haunting Echoes in hand. And you ended up actually casting one. But that whole time as he was... And you ended up getting his Blessings too. But I haven't talked to him about it, and I will if I get a chance to talk to him. But it's like, I would be willing to bet everything I own that he knew that Haunting Echoes was going to happen. And he knew he was going to lose his Blessings and whatever else. And he was setting it up exactly to do what it needed to do. Because I think after that happened, it was just like, I think he managed to find Armageddon again, Armageddon you, and like then, or like Brush Hopper and then Armageddon again. Like, there's no way Rich didn't think of that through. And it was just one of those, like, I've had this feeling playing against Rich, I'm sure you may have too. It's just like, it doesn't matter how good I think I am at Magic right now. I'm not here. I'm just like, there's a plan, it came together, and there's almost like nothing you can do to stop it. I don't know how better to explain. Did that feel that way at all in some of those games?
No, yeah, he got me. He played around it. He knew, but he also knew what he couldn't lose. And he had to give up the blessing. So I wanted to hit it all, obviously, right? I wanted to live the dream. But once I knew that he was going to give up the blessing, and I think it was like 2 other cards that really mattered, except for that Armageddon, I knew. I was like, he knew. Like, he knew exactly what he had to give up. Like, what resources he had to lose, and then how he was going to win this game and close it out. And he did it. So, and he made me play into that. Like, it was well played by him. I mean, like, he's a genius. Like, every time he makes those plays, we're just like, man, like, he knew. And, like, he walked me into it because he knew I had to do it. And how does he not just lose the game? And he made me do it. Like, I couldn't just pass the turn. Like, I had to do it. Like, if I pass the turn, it's over right away. But well orchestrated.
It was interesting because I was at in a position where I heard Mike Flores and Brian Colwall were kind of chatting during the match, and I was hearing Flores be like, "There's no go time," because he's a Tom Stan. I was like, "He can't lose. What's going on? What?" And he's just like, "There's no way Tom loses," and it's just like, I think at some point BK or myself had looked at him and said something that's like, you're really betting against Rich when it matters. Not that I don't love you to death, Tom, but like, I've seen just Rich do stupid things.
Yeah,
and it just goes well. I whatever.
It's like there was a script.
It was.
No, I mean, he made me feel like there was a script written that I didn't agree to. And I just wrote it. Like, I was like, dude, what is going on right now? Like, I was mesmerized. I just went with it. But again, I had to do it, and he set that turn up. That's one game I won't forget because, like, in my head, I was like, "Please leave Armageddon, like, in that graveyard." Like, and then, but he couldn't have everything. He could not have everything, and the way he does not lose the game is to get the Armageddon back. One thing that happened though that was awkward which is why I kind of keep weighing in on, like, two Haunting Echoes is nice, but you get yourself into these situations where you don't want to see both.
And yes, I saw both, 100%. But, yes.
So, yeah, I mean, that's maybe I'm bitter or something.
I don't think you're bitter at all.
Yeah, it's just one of those situations where, like, you didn't want to see both, but there's some, like, against Parfait, you want to have access to two, but you don't want to see both. I think I had one in hand, and I'm pretty sure I drew the next one for turn. I was like, that is the actual worst draw I could have seen. Like, you want the other one on the bottom of your deck, you know?
Exactly. And I think that shows the power of, against all matchups, things like Duress. Peak has been showing up in some deck lists. Like, the ability to understand what's in your opponent's hand, because at some point he did something that made you reveal your hand. I assumed it would have been his Duress, and he saw the two things there. So, or Peak could have done the same thing. I've been experimenting with Peak and Stasis a little bit, just because information in those sorts of matches are key. And it's just like, okay, so now I can build it. So it was a really great match to watch. I find it hard when two friends of mine are playing to really pick somebody I want to win, which was really hard through this whole thing. It's like, man, I want Jeff to win some of these, but I don't want him to beat everybody else. Darn it, I lost to Jeff, but it's okay because he won. It was really weird experience for me. So what, after kind of dust settled, took a day to, you know, shake off any sort of disappointment that came from maybe coming out of the top four and not making it through, what were your takeaways from this PSS?
It was a lot of fun. We got to see a wide variety of matchups that are very entertaining. And yeah, I hope, you know, I just can't wait for the next one. Again, if I'm in it or not, I'm really looking forward to it. I mean, it's not, I'm going to say it again, it's not Hoyt and Flint's fault, but for me and Jared to exit from the PSS against a banned deck, or a deck with a banned card in it, it's not a good feeling. And I was really hoping we could ban a top four deck, specifically just because of that. I know there was definitely some, you know, sure, like, it's last farewell. I didn't give two shits about a farewell to it. But because it's gone already, right? I think at that point I would have wished we implemented the ban there, because I would have banned Parfait just so I don't have to play against it. But to be to exit from the PSS on a, it was, that bothered me the most. It's just because, like, the nonsense, the deck, you just saw what it does. Like, it's just, you know, it's miserable. It's completely miserable to lose against it and be behind. Luckily, the games didn't go that bad. They were still miserable. You know, just how the deck, once the engine's going, you really can't come back. It was just, that's my other big takeaway, all right? If you want to say the last farewell, sure, you got to see it. It's gone. But now I'm excited that, you know, it's gone forever. Like, you know, PSS is over. Right. You won't see it again unless, you know, people just want to continue playing on the side for, you know, fun.
Fun.
Yeah. Rich loves it. I don't know. But,
Rich does love himself so much.
No, but yes, I mean, yeah, I mean, the takeaway was just, it was fun, and you get to see how good Premodern is for the gameplay and the experience, and just, like, you don't get to, like, it's hard to find a format like this where everyone is just so friendly and competitive at the same time, and everyone can feel like it's an open door policy, right? Where random people can just reach out to somebody if you don't even know each other and just bounce ideas off, and then you just become friends and you start talking more. And it's just, I don't know. I gained all that stuff from this one because I knew almost everyone in it, but really got to talk to more people I didn't know too well. Yeah, and now, you know, I consider all of these people my friends because we built that relationship and we had fun, you know? So, yeah, that's my biggest takeaway. And, but yeah, I just want to keep throwing out there, I was sent packing by a band card. So, and so is Jared. I'm taking up with Jared too. It's not right, Will. It's not right.
It's not right. Well, whenever you're in Madison next, I'll buy you a beer or a drink or something. We'll console you then. That's all I can really offer you.
One quick thing.
Yeah.
I do, like, I like being the, like, when you were saying, like, you know, you and BK were like, you can't go against Rich in these pressure situations like that. Like, I like being the underdog. I just, like that feeling. And if it's sports or poker or match, like, I like being the underdog. So when, like, it's funny how it all ended up. When BK, when you guys did the draft for the Lobstercon, and BK picked me first, I was like, you know, like, I didn't feel the pressure too much, but I was like, something's got to happen, right?
So BK jinxed you, is what you're saying.
I think he did. He really did.
Okay. All right.
No, but I mean, I really appreciate, like, him thinking that highly of me. I mean, you know, BK is an amazing player. We played in a monthly couple. He outplayed me with his red-green deck. Like, he's a great player, but, I mean, oh, man. Now I'm getting worked up a little bit because thinking about LobsterCon, I still have unfinished business. Actually, when I submitted Landstill for PSS, I put Landstill and then a parenthesis, I put unfinished business because I have unfinished business from LobsterCon. Like, I was great. I had IV fluids after I got back from the hospital that morning from getting food poisoning.
Uh-huh.
I walk in, I'm feeling good. Just got my IV fluids. I'm cruising.
Uh-huh.
And round two hits, and I hit like a wall again, and I felt nauseous. And I remember me and Fran were trying to find a CVS when I left the hospital, like, to get the script filled, because he was like, "Hey, you might feel nauseous in a little bit when the medicine, you know, the IV fluids and the medicines wear off,"
yeah,
which happened. But me and Fran couldn't. And I was like, "Let's just go, man. We got a tournament to play." I have unfinished business.
Well, LobsterCon ain't going anywhere. It'll be there next year, so you just have to take it down then. Just don't eat salad.
I'm still never going to go to Five Guys again, and I'm not. I told my wife I'm packing. Like, I'm not eating. I'm bringing my own food, like I'm just not. I don't think I'm going to eat out the entire time on the way there or when I'm there. I'm going to eat like granola bars, and, like,
yeah.
Peanut butter
and crackers.
Yeah, I'm just not taking a risk at a random place. Like, I'm just going to eat the, you know, the packaged food with a lot of preservatives that can't make you, they're not good for you, but they can't make, you know, usually you won't get sick, you know?
That's very true. That's very,
I mean, there's no
true
science or data into any of that. So,
just a feeling we have. So bottom line is PSS was a great experience to play in. You've had a chance to do a few of them. You've had success. You brought some great decks and we had great moments. Before we wrap up, because we're almost an hour and a half, so this has been our longest one yet, something about you just letting me let you talk and having discussions, we always go long, but I have three questions. The first question is, what is the most overrated card in Premodern?
Man, I wish I remember what I said last time, but for overrated, oh no, Lanny's going to kill me. Lanny will kill me. It's Mox Diamond.
Mox Diamond. There it is. All right.
So I actually am not a fan of Mox Diamond in the format, but it's fine. And I think it's a little overrated because of the card disadvantage. Like, I think that's the one reason why it's probably fine because of it being card disadvantage. But yeah, maybe that's why I'm like sticking. Like, I don't like cards that really do that. Kind of like why I got away from Groatog. I know Lanny loves it. I mean, I love that deck. Like, but the one reason why, I mean, you run Gush and stuff like that. But just like, I don't know. Lose discarding I don't know, man. I just, not something I like to do.
I get it. I get it. It makes sense.
Yeah, but I think it's a little overrated because some decks can utilize it correctly. But I don't know. I don't see the hype. I see Mox Diamonds lose a lot. So,
yeah, they get blown up pretty easily too.
Yeah, and again, the artifact hate, you know, is, I mean, most decks run some main board. So, not that you're gonna hit a Mox Diamond all the time. I did hit one. I played against Lane in the Magic Online Society finals 2 weeks ago. It was Goblins Him Replenish, and there was a scenario where I just locked him out. Yeah, I think I wastelanded him, and then his upkeep, I hit his Mox Diamond, and he was locked.
Yep.
So. It's overrated, all right? So,
all right, fair enough. What is your most underrated card in Premodern?
Stifle.
Yes. 100% yes. For a little tidbit for Stasis players, if you want, I have two Stifles in my sideboard because Wasteland has made an appearance again. everybody loves their Wastelands again, and boy, howdy, does Wasteland not like a stifle.
It's true. I wish there was, like, the best stifle deck is Dreadnought, but it's because of, you know, the synergy with Dreadnought. But I really tried to make stifle not work. I mean, a stifle work in like Tog, like a Tog. I've kind of been flexing in and out with it, but I tried to like make a Delver stifle deck, being Psychotog, but I still think it's underrated. It's just such a powerful effect, and it kind of got pushed out of Legacy. It doesn't really see play anymore. It actually doesn't see play at all anymore, but it's I think it's one of the it's one of the strongest cards in Premodern. It just doesn't have like good homes outside of Dreadnought. But like you said, you can run it in the sideboard of like Replenish. I mean, decks that would care about a like that you would want to trigger something like a Replenish stifling a Tormod's Crypt or something, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. So there are there's situations like that, but I wish there was like a just like a stifle. I guess I being biased, I just want there to be a Delver deck, but it'd be cool. I just think it's underrated. Like, it's very good at what it does, and sometimes you can stifle a Wasteland and get or a fetch land and get them. It doesn't happen enough in Premodern. I wish it happened more. But
yeah, it's very there's like there could be like a Merfolk deck, maybe like a tempo Merfolk-y deck, maybe or something like that. But I love it because it gets a Wasteland. Gets a Druid activation. There's not a single deck it doesn't have a target for, truly, if you need be. But I agree with you on that. How about card needing to be broken?
Yeah, this one was hard to decide on, because I think last time I went with Mana Bond, and I think I said Cabal Ritual also. Yeah, this one's tough.
By the way, I've had Mana Bond in my slide deck for a little while.
Really? Sideboard. Interesting.
Or no, sorry, mana. Did you say? Did you mean bond or barbs?
Mana bond. Mana bond. No. Oh wait, so no, you're saying burn. So it was just.
So I had mana barbs. Mana barbs. I apologize. Yes.
Mana bond's the green enchantment.
Yeah. Okay, never mind.
So. It's a tough one. One card I always think about, but I just don't know if it can like get there because it doesn't have like anything else to. But there is a deck. I'll give Artie a shout out. I actually tested a couple games with it. I think I tested two or three games. I didn't lose a game with it, but it's just probably a worse version of like Angry Hermit or Feb, or like Hermit Feb or whatever. Shout out to Mike Harris for winning the New York tournament, by the way.
Yep.
But I would say Cephalid Illusionist. Like the
yes,
that ability is so busted. Like it just needs like a Lab Maniac win con. That's the only problem.
Yep, there's nothing like that.
No, but I've played three games with it, three matches with it on Magic Online with Artie's. He made a Cephalid breakfast deck, and yeah, I think you might have seen it. I played three decks. I didn't lose a game with it. Maybe it's the next deck, man. Maybe it's the next one. But that the ability is so unique, and like you can win very fast. I think you can win. I think it can turn one. I think it has to be Magical Christmas Land, but I'm pretty with Lotus Petal. Turn one.
So what is it usually? Lotus. It has to be Lotus Petal. Cephalid Illusionist costs two.
Yes.
Because you need Illusionist. You need at least a Nomad's Encore.
Yep.
To target it a bunch, drop everything in the graveyard, reanimate.
Yeah, reanimate.
So you need 1, 2, 3, 4 mana.
Yes. Yeah, you reanimate, you get the Sutured Ghoul, and then you...
Dragon's Breath it. Yep.
I think you could turn one.
Can you? Because you would have to go land... All right, so you need... What is it? Sorry, we're doing math here.
Right? I haven't done this.
Yeah, I think it... So you need Reanimate in your hand, Illusionist, Nomad, so that's three cards. So you have four cards left, so it would be land, three petals.
That does it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, Illusionist, two mana, Nomad, land for the reanimate. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, land, three petals, and those three cards.
Yeah, I mean, it's late.
I mean, it's certainly Christmas land. There's no doubt about this.
It can happen. If you can turn two a Dreadnought, you can turn one with Cephal Illusionist.
Yeah. But imagine how... Or he also runs Didn't he also run Elvish Spirit Guide too in that?
There might be one.
Okay, sweet. So yeah, it's definitely
in theory, but you gotta pay for days.
I think days is overrated. I really do. Oh, no, I hate that card. No, it's not.
It's one of the best.
We'll argue about that. We'll argue about that later and why it's bad as a four of. How about that?
Maybe, but it's so good, Will. It's crazy how it's been standing the test of time. Like the fact that it's still just so broken. It's gotten a little worse in Legacy with it's just crazy. Like I don't know. That is so. The free spells are so. When you get free spells.
Sure. I'll give you days. Days isn't good in Stasis, in my opinion.
Okay. Okay.
And we can cover that later. And Dreadnought, sure. Sure. Yeah, in any case. So you had an additional question. What was your fourth question? What was our bonus question?
Oh, yeah. So I was listening to you speak with Mike Arnold. I got to listen to that one. What's the best card in pre-modern? I don't know if I want to say best or most powerful, because I think they're two different things. I think the most powerful card is Cabal Therapy. But I think... What are you gonna say? It's so broken.
Meddling Mage.
Okay. How about this? Okay, Meddling Mage is the most powerful, the most skill intensive card. Might be Cabal Therapy, and then second might be Meddling Mage.
Sure, I gotta go more along with that. Absolutely.
But I was saying,
do I have any argument?
What's the best card? And Will, I'm gonna ask you. This is where you know.
Okay, best card.
I'm not interviewing you, Will.
Naturalize.
You know what's funny? I was telling who did I say this to? Fran Lanny. I think I was telling Fran Lanny and Mike. I said the second best removal spell. I put removal in parentheses. I'm not sure what I meant by that, but I think it's Source of Plaster is one, Naturalize two. So I'm with you.
So the reason I say Naturalize over Swords. Is because outside of Goblins, there is no deck in this format in which Naturalize does not hit something significant. There is absolutely none.
I can't think of, if we went through TC decks right now and started looking at everything, this format is warped. It's in a good way, because I don't think any format has that, right? It's warped by enchantments and artifacts.
Yep. You want Naturalize against Stasis, you want it against Dreadnought, you want it against Elves, you want it against, Angry Hermit to get a Dragon's Breath, or you want it against Sly to get a Vortex, there's not a match outside of Goblins where it doesn't matter.
I don't think you're wrong. It's like, and then what makes Goblins so good is they don't care, so people are going to have dead cards against you game one because decks are going to be having it, and then that's the main thing. They don't care. So
they don't need artifacts.
Yeah, it makes goblins. It makes goblins game one very good. So
yes, exactly. So I would say Naturalize, probably followed by. I would switch your order because the knock against Swords, in my opinion, is it kills really good creatures, but it's a blank against enchantments or artifacts that you care about. Whereas Naturalize is not, it doesn't kill creatures, but it kills the most relevant creature that matters in most cases that you're most scared about, which is Dreadnought.
Yeah. So I think I might go with you, honestly. Like, we have Gush and Survival, but we were talking about this after the 1.5K. You don't just see these powerful cards that are banned in Legacy or restricted in Vintage dominating like all these tournaments. Like, the 1.5K, for example, is a cutthroat tournament to win cash. Like, first place was, I think, 550 cash at the door. Like, people wanted to win, not just for like for clout. It's just, we wanted to win that money. And we saw, like, it's one Gush deck and one Survival deck. Like, that's it. Like, even though they are completely broken, they're not like the best card. I do think I wrote down Naturalize is the best card. Some people say, like, so it's close, but like Duress is really good. Some people say, like, oh, Duress is overrated, it misses, like, but you don't understand what information it can be backbreaking. Like, you can miss under duress and win the game because you have free information. Like, you can play around exactly what they're doing. Like, sure, you're not going to see the rest of their hand when they start drawing, but, like, it's so much information. Like, when I get duress, I don't like that feeling because then, you know, I really don't. You now have to, like, your opponent can play around with what you're doing. You know, it kind of breaks like the rules of Magic a little bit, where it's like now your opponent can see your hand, kind of thing. Where it's like you know, would Magic be better if everyone had what's that enchantment where you see everyone's hand? What the hell is that called?
Telepathy.
That's it. Like, yep. Would Magic be good that way? I don't think so. But
I would play that in Stasis. I'd play it in Stasis all the time.
That card's not great. Bad. But if it drew a card, it'd probably be playable, but it's not playable, actually.
That we got Peak for that.
Right. But, I mean, the information thing is so thing. I don't when people say, like, oh, Duress is overrated, like, no, it's not. Like,
yeah, Duress for me is better than Therapy. I think it's better than Therapy, 100%.
There's definitely situations where it is, but, like, even if I miss on a Duress, like, it's just, like, it's not like, oh, I lose now. It's like, no, okay, I got free information. I think you gain some edges there having information.
And it's just the fact that you also, the control deck really in most cases needs to counter that because they're going to lose their most powerful threat anyway. So no, I think Duress, those things are great. Information's amazing. And it's not something everybody considers as highly as they should.
Yep.
So before we go, Tom, I know I bought out the Premodern Bros podcast.
Yes, I appreciate that.
Is a successful buyout.
I am now retired.
Well, we're gonna bring you back. So hopefully in the future when time is available, I would love to have him join future casts. So hopefully you'll get to see that soon. But you also have a very cool series with Francisco on YouTube. It's Dueling Grounds?
Yes.
Two or three episodes in at this point.
I think we are four because...
Is it four?
Yes, I think so because he's...
Okay.
I'm 1-3 against him, so...
1-3? Okay, well, we're going to step that percentage up.
I know. Fran is, honestly, he's one of the best Magic players I know. He's so good.
He is. Yeah. I agree. I agree, so...
Yeah, and I feel like when we're talking and I see him play, like, even when I used to watch him when he was, like, you know... He's the best Amulet Titan player of all time. I just remember watching him play. I was like, man, this guy is so good. Even just still now, he's just, like, leaps ahead. Like, the things he says, I'm like, man, that's so smart. Like, he knows what he's talking about. Like, it's great to hear, like, his insight on all things, you know... like Magic. Like he just knows it. He knows the game and he just like is so passionate about it. Like his passion is you can't, you know, just find that everywhere. I just love his passion, especially for pre-modern. He loves it. And we're working on that. You know, life gets in the way and he's got a little one and you know, even you will, like we find the time for it, but him and I, we're going to get back to it. We're trying to at least do like we record a few at times just so we had them available. If we have to go on a little bit of a long stretch, but I think we're working on it for next week.
I love it. So sweet. I can't wait to see that. But Tom, thank you again for joining me today. Always a great conversation. PSS 5 has wrapped up. We're waiting anxiously for a PSS 6 to see what happens. Events coming up. We just had the Sacred Torch in New York. I know coverage of that is going to be happening in the next couple weeks, but upcoming Misty Mountain Games has their event this weekend for the Fall Cup out here in Madison, Wisconsin. If you're around, be sure to join up for that. Euros is coming up in a couple of weeks. I know there's some major stuff going down in South America shortly. So it's everywhere. So if you guys want to play pre-modern in-person events, you can check it out on YouTube. Find the Magic Online Society, which Tom is a strong proponent of. I know there's talk about possible Swiss events on Modo coming. It's everywhere.
Well, not too much spoiler. Tom, not too much spoiler. I know we've been bouncing the ideas for a nice, cash prize tournament.
Cash prize. We like cash prizes, don't we?
Yes, more to come. Will, you have a genius. It's genius. More to come on that, but for more competitive, we'll get there. We'll talk about it soon.
We'll get there, absolutely. But guys, it's a pleasure as always to talk to you, the audience, anyone who has comments, let us know. Reach out to Tom, reach out to me, find all the podcasts. Shout out to Spike Cowling, shout out to Premodcast, All Things Considered, Monster of the Week. There's some South American ones and some Spain ones. There's something in Eastern Europe that we've seen. It's everywhere, guys. You can find it. But with that being said, Tom, thank you again for joining me. I've been Will. Everybody have a wonderful night.
See you.
Take care, everybody.